Calcaterra had a persuasive weapon in his arsenal. Hunger. The prisoners got enough to keep them upright and ambulatory, but nowhere near enough to encourage energetic pursuits like digging or running or even calisthenics. Food became of overpowering importance that winter. In the morning, the prisoners received a cup of what they called coffee to wash down a small bread roll, and in the evening a ladle or two of skilly, a thin, watery soup with bits and pieces of pasta or green stalks in it. Or, once a week on average, some small shreds of what might have been meat. Joe supposed that it depended what you were used to, and would never have said so to the other men, but he came to think that PG-57 wasn't too bad. The huts provided adequate shelter. There were beds, ablution blocks, latrines, plenty of drinking water, enough food to stay alive, and time. Joe had never had much time to himself. The closest he'd come to it was at school. His regret at having to leave so young had never gone away, and he was keen to resume learning something, anything. The prisoners were organizing all sorts of activities and courses. Joe went to every dramatic performance, musical, lecture, and quiz, but didn't have the confidence to participate in any of them. He looked at courses in accountancy, agriculture, and French, because he wanted something challenging. The kind of learning that would burn up the oxygen in his head that might otherwise feed the embers of Elm Rare and the Nino Bixio. He decided that he knew as much as he wanted to know about agriculture, so chose accounting, where he was drawn to the logical symmetry of double-entry bookkeeping. Arch Scott, a lanky, genial native of Papakura, and his best mate Paul Day were fluent in French and running classes.